Now we can write down our precise definition of dimension. Suppose we do what we've been doing. That is, we create a geometric structure from a given d-dimensional object, like a line, square, or a cube, by repeatedly dividing the length of its sides by a number, m. So this is just what we were doing before. For example, when we were bisecting the sides, the number m was 2. When we were trisecting the sides, the number m was 3, etc. So this is our recipe. And we saw that at each new level, we got m raised to the d power copies of the figure at the previous level, all shrunken by a factor of m. So let's call the number of copies n. Okay, so we have n is equal to m to the d. We're just renaming this to n. Now we can define d by taking the logarithm of both sides. So there we have log n is equal to d times log m, using one of our logarithm rules that we saw in the previous video. And then we can say that d, dimension, is equal to log n over log m. That is, dimension is defined as the logarithm of the number of copies we get divided by the amount by which we reduce the length of the sides. Okay, let's check to make sure that this formula actually agrees with our standard notion of dimension. To check it for dimension 1, let's take the bisecting version, where m is equal to 2. That is, we divide each side into 2 equal halves. Then m is 2 and n, the number of copies of the line, is 2. So if we say d, the dimension is equal to log 2 over log 2, well, we get 1. So that works because this gives us the correct dimension, dimension 1. So now let's look at that for the trisecting version. For trisecting, m equals 3. We divided each side into 3 equal parts. So remember that for one dimension, n, the number of copies was 3. So we get d equals log 3 over log 3, which equals 1. Again, this works because we get the answer that the dimension is 1. So our formula agrees with what we intuitively would consider to be the answer for the correct dimension. Let's check for two-dimensional objects. For two-dimensional objects, if we're bisecting, then dimension equals log 4 divided by log 2. That's equal to 2. You can check that on your calculator if you like. For trisecting, we get m equals 3 and n equals 9. So d is equal to log 9 divided by log 3, which is also equal to 2. So that works. And finally, for dimension 3, well, I'll let you check that. And I promise you, it works. Now, all of this has been building up to what we really want to do, which is to calculate the dimension of the Koch curve. So if you remember, for the Koch curve, we draw a segment, then we erase its middle third, and then we replace that middle third by an angle whose sides are the same length as the other two sides. That is, one third of the original segment in this configuration. Then we iterate that again and again until we finally come up with something that looks like this. And we can keep going for as long as we want. So for the Koch curve, m equals 3. That is, remember, we're reducing the side of the segments by a factor of 3. N, the number of copies at each level, is 4. At each level, we replace the figure at the previous level with 4 copies arrayed in this configuration. So according to our definition, the dimension of the Koch curve is log 4 divided by log 3. That is log n divided by log m, which, if you put it on your calculator, you'll find is approximately 1.26. But what exactly does this mean? Well, for one thing, it means that the dimension of this curve approximates 1.26. That is, it gets closer and closer to 1.26 as we iterate through more and more levels. But what does the 1.26 mean? What does a dimension that's between 1 and 2 actually mean? Well, it's not easy to understand this intuitively, but I can say that it's a measure of how the number of copies scales with the decrease in the size of the segment. Very roughly, it's sort of the density of the self-similarity. For regular geometric figures, this dimension is an integer. But for fractals, which have a possibly higher density of self-similarity, the dimension can be fractional. So just to give you a feel for this, let me quote a little bit from my own book, Complexity, A Guided Tour, where I talk about what fractal dimension means. So to quote, I have seen many attempts at intuitive descriptions of what fractal dimension means. For example, it has been said that fractal dimension represents the roughness, ruggedness, jaggedness, or complicatedness of an object, an object's degree of fragmentation, and how, quote, dense the structure of the object is. But one description I like a lot is the rather poetic notion that fractal dimension, quote, quantifies the cascade of detail, unquote, in an object. That is, it quantifies how much detail you can see at all scales as you dive deeper and deeper into the infinite cascade of self-similarity. For structures that aren't fractals, such as a smooth, round marble, if you keep looking at the structure with increasing magnification, eventually there's a level with no interesting details. Fractals, on the other hand, have interesting details at all levels. And fractal dimension, in some sense, quantifies how interesting that detail is as a function of how much magnification you have to do at each level to see it. So that was the description from my book. And of course, that description of having interesting detail at all levels applies to perfect mathematical fractals, but it's approximated by what we call fractals in nature.